Hey, Gunn, and welcome everyone to this November 1st edition of the 5-Star News. I'm Gunnar Bryson.
And I'm Owen Bryant, and we hope everyone had a great Halloween last night. Looks like you did, Gunnar.
Yeah, it was pretty good, but let's get to the news now, and we'll start out today's show like all the others with some school announcements.
Sounds good. Here's What's Up Heritage with Isaac Gunn.
Hope you guys had a great Halloween. Now, let's get over to some Tuesday announcements. Today is our blood drive, so for everybody that has signed up for it, please be there to donate. Attention juniors. Your junior class field trip is tomorrow, so be sure that you are prepared for your exciting field trip. And lastly, congrats to all the people competing in the One Act competition. Hope you all gave a stellar performance. Now, let's get on to the weather. For Tuesday, it will be cloudy with a high 72 and a low of 53. On Wednesday, it will be sunny with a high 74 and a low of 45. And for Thursday, it will be sunny with a high 75 and a low of 48. Now, let's get back to the anchors for more news.
Good job, Ike. And now onto the news. I'm sure you know that Heritage is a wonderful school filled with great students and staff, Owen.
There's no doubt about that, Gunner.
Yes, and this awesome school of ours comes up with some awesome fundraisers throughout the year that benefit us in so many ways.
Yes, but with the holidays coming up, our school's annual Thanksgiving food drive might be the most important event of the school year.
Totally agree, Owen. How do students and staff get involved this year?
Well, it's pretty simple. Basically, just bring in food. But there's a lot more to our food drive than that. Here's 5-Star News reporters Ethan Anderson, Aaliyah Hensley, and Penner Alton with the report.
All right, FBLA is sponsoring the Thanksgiving food drive again this year. And it starts today, October the 31st, and goes until November the 15th. So we want all of our first block classes to participate and bring in food. All the food is distributed locally to our local families, and it really helps out. Some years we've had as much as over 6,000 items brought in, and so we hopefully we'll hit that amount. During the pandemic years, we were a little bit lower, but things are rolling good now, and if people will participate, it really help out our people in need, our local families.
Okay, so the Thanksgiving food drive has started. Thanksgiving's just right around the corner. Halloween's over, so we're moving into the Thanksgiving season, and it's time to do the Thanksgiving food drive. So every year, all the first block classes compete against each other to bring in the most canned foods, and hopefully my first block will win, so we'll see if that happens. I have great kids in first block, so I have high hopes. But most importantly, of course, it's because we want to provide a lot of great Thanksgiving treats and lots of great food for our families and our community so that everybody has a good Thanksgiving. So please contribute and participate in the food drive. It's a wonderful thing to do.
Oh, we've had a number of winners over the years with Miss Sawyer's classes, Miss Wolf, Miss Petty's, and Miss Wilson, and also Coach Broom and Miss Chatton. A lot of times those classes have done really well and won the pizza party that we're going to have for them, whoever the top class is. So, you know, encourage your classmates to participate and come on in and help out with the Thanksgiving food drive.
Hey, this is Fairy.
And Mr. Dotson.
And we're here to talk to you about the food drive, which started yesterday and goes till the 15th. What we're doing is we're taking up canned goods and non-perishables, and we'll be donating those to local pantries and food organizations. Last year, they had about 2,000 cans, and we expect to double that this year. Dodson, I challenge your first block class. We're going to win.
Unfortunately, I don't have a first block class.
Well, that stinks. Hey, you guys bring in canned goods.
Yeah, I'm bringing food for the food drive this week, and I'm bringing it because it really benefits our community, and people who don't have access to food easily will get it, so I think that's great. And then also it benefits me because I'm getting National Honor Society hours from it, and this will complete my hours for that, so that'll be nice. And yeah, so basically that's it. All right, students, the ball is in our court for donations. Let's break all the previous records this year.
Sounds good to me. Moving on now, there's some important things happening this week down in our work-based learning department.
Sure are, and we spent some time yesterday with our work-based learning director, Vaughn Crane, to find out just what's going to be happening in the spring with work-based learning. Check it out.
So we're currently accepting applications for the work-based learning program for the spring semester. I've had some questions about it. A lot of kids want to know, how do I get involved in it? One is, come down here and get an information card from me. You'll fill out a preliminary information card for me, letting me know a little bit about yourself. The main thing you need to know is you need to be a junior or a senior in good academic standing, minimal absences. You don't have to have a job to apply. If you don't have one, we'll help you find one. And you have to have 3 teacher recommendations and no discipline. So there are some requirements to get into the program.
I'm kind of looking forward to it. Obviously, I feel like you got to have a job for it, but this year they've got it where you don't have to have a job before you do it, so I think I'm going to at least apply for it. I may not get it. I'm struggling a little bit in some classes, but looking forward to getting that up and trying to do work-based learning later in the year.
Work-based learning.
I've been doing work-based learning mainly because it helps me get out of school early, but also gives me extra hours at work, a little bit of extra money doesn't hurt, and if you already have most of your classes done, you know, most of your core classes, whatever, then it's just a good way to get out of school early, earn a little bit of extra money, you know.
We're trying to place seniors first, and then we'll kind of start putting juniors in, but if you're going to apply, now's the time to do it. We're going to take applications a few more days, and then we're going to start going through and figuring out who's going to be in for the spring semester. So if you're interested, just come down to the Career Center and see me.
Well, I think it'll benefit later on because having a job, obviously, right out of high school is definitely going to help, and having that secure thing to fall back on. I mean, obviously, you get the chance to look for another job after you get out of high school, but having a part-time job where you go to school and go to work every day, I think will help in the future.
Make sure to take care of that soon. Moving on now to Catoosa County Superintendent of Schools, Chance Nix, was on campus yesterday to provide a big honor to members of the Emperor of the Taj.
Sure was, Gunner, and he presented these medals for the work collecting over $25,000 in the Emperor of the Taj fundraiser this year. Here's Coach Green with the story.
A board member wanted to provide you guys with something that's called the Superintendent's Medal, and we give this to students anytime they do something spectacular, and you guys have done it.
Well, I'm super excited to be at Heritage today. We had an incredible opportunity to honor 7 amazing generals, the Emperor of the Taj. They raised over $25,000 for the Catoosa County Children's Fund. And those funds go to pay folks electric bills, water bills, food bills, and rental assistance that are really falling on tough times. And so I think this is just an amazing example of great kids having compassion to see other needs rather than their own, and some pretty cool entrepreneurship. $25,000 is a lot of money.
So the superintendent and Mr. Lust threw us a luncheon today and brought us pizza bros and some dessert and drinks just to recognize us for all that we did for the Emperor of the Taj race. So it was amazing. We love being here and being able to fellowship with everybody, so it was great.
Through y'all's donations, we were able to collect over $25,000. Which is going to help serve 170-something families. And when I mean help them, I mean keep them from being evicted, keep the power on, water on, food on the table, clothes on the back, all of that. And so you guys will never truly know the impact that your donation is going to have on these families here in our own backyard.
It makes me feel really good. I love being able to help people. And so just this being another way of helping the community out just makes us feel really good.
There are some really major fundraisers that we have in the school system that don't come close to $25,000. So to see these kids take something like that and really run with it is really, it's really pretty special.
So we got the Superintendent Nix gave us the Superintendent's Award of Excellence Medal. We're able to wear it at graduation, so it's really cool. It makes us feel really good that we're being recognized and actually have something to take with us.
And so today I provided each one of those students with a Superintendent's Medal, and the board helps me whenever we award those so the kids recognize what a remarkable and special thing that they've accomplished. And then it's great. Director Lust got some great pizza for us from Pizza Bros, and they're just having a really good time.
Good stuff, you guys. Now, time for a quick commercial break here on the show, but stick around. Brady Irvin will join us with sports next.
Yes, and I'll have the recap of unbelievable football win by our Generals over Sonoraville. And trust me, you don't want to miss these highlights. Stick and stay. Sports is next.
Thank you. Would you like to make a donation?
Yeah, sure.
Star Sports with Brody Irvin starts now.
Welcome into sports, everybody. Brody Irvin here, and if you didn't get out to Jess Sims Field last Friday night to watch our Generals take on Snorville, you missed what a lot of people are saying was the best football game ever played here at Heritage. Phoenix and Generals came in tied for a second place in the region, and a win would give that team the inside track for a home playoff berth in the GHSA state football playoff in a few weeks. With all of that on the line, this game turned into an instant classic. Here's Coach Green with a look back with the Generals' remarkable 35-34 win.
Lots of seniors, lots of memories being made as the Generals take the field.
Senior night at Jeff Sims Field last Friday night as our Generals took the field for a huge region game against Sonoraville. We pick up the action in the first quarter with the Generals trailing 7-0, but that lead wouldn't last long as the Generals tie this baby up at 7 on this 3-yard touchdown run by Logan Kanzler. Second quarter now, still tied at 7, but the Generals would take the lead on another short touchdown run. This time it's Caden Swope calling his own number, and he just breaks the plane, 14-7 HHS. Still 14-7 now in the second quarter when Heritage's offense strikes again. This time it's from long distance as Swope fires long down the near sideline to a wide-open Tyler Cheatwood. Cheatwood's catch and run would go 77 yards and give the Generals a 21-7 lead at halftime.
Impressive pitch and catch by Swope over to Tyler Cheatwood.
After a great dance by the Generals band at the halftime break, our Generals picked up where they left off in the second quarter with another quick touchdown. Here, number 3, Paxton McCrary gets into pay dirt from 5 yards out, and it's 28-7 Heritage, and this one's over, right? Wrong. Sonorville would rally and score 3 out of the next 4 touchdowns scored on the night. This one comes on a short touchdown run by their running back, Zach Lyles, and that would cut the lead to 28-21 Heritage. But our Generals appear to get another knockout shot with this long touchdown from Swope to Cheatwood. This one's a great catch in the corner of the end zone, 25 yards in all, 35-21 Heritage. But that touchdown only set the stage for yet another Sonorville comeback. 35-28 now Heritage, but the Phoenix would pull within 1 point on this quarterback keeper by Jackson Pate. 35-34 Heritage with the extra point still pending. Sonorville could tie it up with the extra point, but their kicker misses the kick wide left. Generals seem to win it again. It's 35-34 Generals with only 37 seconds left in the game. Sonora would have to go onside kick, and they do it, and they recover it to give them one last shot to win it late in the fourth quarter. Fourth down now, the Sonoraville Phoenix has one more play. Their pass goes long down the left sideline, but it's out of bounds. The Generals win it 35-34 and a wild one.
I'm incredibly proud, man. That's a really good football team, man. Those guys are big and strong and talented. The little quarterback's tough to deal with. And I mean, I just can't believe the effort of our guys. There's so many times we could have packed it in, we could have gave up, and they just came back and they fought over and over and over again. All three phases made plays. Just super proud of the guys.
I knew they were going to be physical, but they were a whole lot physical or more physical than I thought they were going to be. You know, they came out swinging. We kind of shut them up in the first half, and then they came out swinging again, and I knew it would be a dogfight in the end.
Yeah, they're a pretty good team. We had a few mistakes out there. We got to clean some stuff up if we want to make a run in the playoffs. But, I mean, I'm really proud of what we did tonight, proud of our effort, proud of our preparation this week. I mean, I couldn't ask for anything else.
Thanks for sports, Brody. Now back for some entertainment news on this Tuesday. And with Halloween just wrapping up, our very own Owen and I hit the hallways yesterday to find out just what some of our students' biggest fears are.
Yep, and it sounds like a lot of them had some crazy fears.
I'm Cletus Snow from Smokey and the Bandit.
And I'm some guy from Seattle, and welcome to this Halloween edition of Owen and Ike's Ideas. In today's edition of Owen and Ike's Ideas, we're going to be talking about what's your deepest fear.
Well, I think my deepest fear is probably the Mississippi River. I done wrecked a couple trucks in there, but I think it's okay. I mean, we pulled them out afterwards. But, you know, I wonder, what's yours?
I mean, like, I feel like this is a pretty common one. It's fear of heights because, I mean, like, whenever I was, like, really young, I went to, like, the top of the Empire State Building, and that alone just terrified me. So that's what gave me the fear of heights.
Well, I mean, I was way off. I'm over here talking about wrecking trucks in a river, and you're like, fear of heights. Well, I reckon we need to check in with our guests. What do you think they think?
I think we should do that. So, Cole, if you have to choose between anything, what would have to be your scariest fear?
Probably, I don't have a fear of heights, but I have a fear of falling from heights. Like, it's weird. It's, like, amplified during dreams. Like, I'll be on, like, some ledge somewhere, and I'll be like, ah! It freaks me out.
So, what would have to be your scariest fear?
Probably the ocean. I don't like that we barely know anything about it, and it's way too big for my liking.
I can also agree on that. Sometimes it can be very scary, especially not even discovering all of it.
I don't like that we know more about outer space than the ocean at all.
Moving on now to some Halloween decorating that took place down in our hallway.
Yes, and Miss Wells' art students had a great time carving pumpkins last week.
Sure did, and hopefully everyone took the time to go down and check them out last week.
Our cameras were there, and we talked to a few of the art students that took place in the carving.
In the fall, I teach a sculpture class, and every year in sculpture, one of the ways that we are able to implement subtractive sculpture, which is where they have to carve or take away the material, is through pumpkin carving. It's a great medium to work with, and it's something that we can work with pretty quickly. So the students all get to choose to work independently or with a partner. Their designs have to be original, but that doesn't mean that they can't use references from other things. So yes, the kids get very excited, they're very competitive. So on Monday, we open the pumpkins up, they clean them out and start their designs, and they have to be finished by the end of class on Thursday for the pumpkins to be on display Friday. The kids really enjoy it. It's fun for the week of Halloween. So last Friday, the pumpkins were on display during lunch. The whole school was able to come down and see them and to even vote. The winner was Lily Spence, and hers was pumpkin number 9. It was the pumpkin with the wire around the eye and the mouth, and it kind of had a nasty brain kind of gouged out in the top. So she will get to have lunch of her choice this week. She's pretty excited about that.
Really happy that I won. I carved my pumpkin, and I tried to make the eyes really scary, and I gave it a brain, added some paint to it to make it look like blood, and I put wires all in it just to make, I was trying to make it as scary as possible.
Oh, Lily's was great, no doubt. I've seen it, I've seen the process and all that, and it's definitely up there being one of my favorites.
Wow, those all look pretty good. And with that, we'll wrap up this Tuesday edition of 5-Star News.
We'll see you again on Friday with a brand new report, but until then, stay classy, Heritage.